have the panel come on. So we have quite a few people who are knee-deep, neck-deep in the containers, microservices, security spaces. So first of all, I'd like to welcome Sunit Nandwani. He's head of infrastructure at eBay, Cloud and Platforms. So Sumit, maybe we start off with you over there. Then some of you might have seen Tim on the original posters that went out. And so Tim Hawkins from Google, he had a bit of a conflict because he was speaking at Google Next today. And so he said, hey, how did you commit to two events at the same time? Didn't you use Google Calendar? He said, no. What about Google Search? No. So he said, OK, I'll make it up to you guys and you know, do something. So he said, why don't you just go in a self-driving car, come over here. You know, Google's going to do that, avoid the traffic. He said, I'll do something even better. So we were thinking he's going to, you know, do something drone-related. But what he did was say, I'm going to nominate Prashant to come and join and stand in for me. So Prashant from Google is here. He's into the Kubernetes space. So you'll see that when he speaks, there's a lot of knowledge, experience that comes in there. Third, I would like to invite from Nirmata, Jim Bugwadia, an ex-Cisco colleague of mine. I was with Cisco till a few months ago. So Jim's kind of really changing the space in containerization. He's a CEO of a startup as well. And then from Cisco, I'd like to invite Vipin Jain. So Vipin's somebody whom I worked with for almost 15 years. So he's getting into the open source space with Project Conti. We'll talk a little bit about that. And then from Cybric, I'm going to ask Mike Kyle to join. And Mike's, again, looking at this space from Cybric as a security vendor. They're still in a pseudo-stealth mode. But he's also the guy who headed up infrastructure at Yahoo, where he was SVP of infrastructure, as well as Netflix, which are really the poster children for web scale today. So that's kind of the panel that we have today. And I'm going to park myself here as well and get the show rolling. And in between, we'll have a bit of a surprise demo as well. And that's going to be headed by Dos Dosanjo there. So we wanted to bring some of the concepts that we talk into life and go beyond PowerPoint. Right? So let's maybe have you guys start off talking a bit about yourself. What is it that you do? And how is it relevant to the space that we're all here gathered to learn about? So let's kick things off with you.
Okay, so my name is Sunit Nandwani. So I lead the internal cloud team at eBay. So it's we have a pretty large-scale internal cloud. It's all OpenStack-based. And so my team does all the engineering and the operations of that, of the private cloud. I think what's relevant is that, you know, we are probably one of the biggest OpenStack implementations today in the world, but as we are looking forward, one of the places we are really investing in deeply and looking at with a lot of interest is how to run containers and how to take eBay and move that to a lot of the applications internally to containers and use leverage microservices. So it's, I would say it's still early in the journey, but it's relevant because we are learning every day.
I'm Prashant. I work on Kubernetes. I joined the team before 1.0. And
get the mic louder.
Yeah. Okay, sorry. I am, as of right now, author and maintainer of replication controller, ingress, and also handle various areas of networking like services and load balancing, and things like flaky tests and, you know, merging PRs and all that. So that's essentially it.
So hi, everyone. I'm Jim Bugwadia. I'm a co-founder and CEO at Nirmata. So what we do at Nirmata is we provide multi-cloud container services for enterprise DevOps teams. So my co-founders and I, we started Nirmata because we realized more and more software is becoming critical to our day-to-day lives. And we believe we need better ways of operating, managing software at scale. So at Nirmata, kind of bringing it back to containers and microservices. Of course, you know, we're all into that. And not only do we provide solutions for the space, but everything we build is in containers. We run on cloud providers as microservices style applications.
Yeah, hi, my name is Vipin. I'm a lead developer in Conti project. It is a Cisco sponsored open source project where we are trying to define the operational policies, which we believe is very crucial when containers need to be taken to production. How containers get deployed, what kind of policies are needed with respect to authentication, networking, who gets to access who, what prioritization do you need for various container workloads. So primarily focusing on networking and storage policies for containers at Conti.
Hello, everyone. Mike Hiles, Chief Innovation Officer and co-founder at Cybric, which since we're about 6 months old, I was going to describe as an Uber for Uber, but I figured that was not descriptive enough. So how I'll describe it is we're an automation orchestration platform focused on security. And our backend infrastructure is leveraging Kubernetes, Docker containers, and it's a completely microservices-based architecture.
Great. So now that we got a sense of who the panel is, I want to get a sense of who you guys are. And if you could just, by a show of hands, let us know how many of you are exposed to containers who are actually working on them. Great. Microservices, how many of you are seeing it in your environment? Okay. Who's using public clouds today? Container pool, right? Docker, Kubernetes, okay. Mesos. Who came here just for the beer? All right, so.
Shashi, I have a question.
Yeah.
How many people are using Docker containers or any containers in production today? Yeah, in production. Thanks.
So of the three hands, one was an Appcito hand. Okay, so let's sort of go start drilling down into this. Let's start here and then we go deep, right? So today, if you look at containers and your microservices, there's a lot of hype about it, but when I look at Gartner's hype cycle, I don't see this being reflected there. What is it that is driving so many people to really explore this as a technology? What is the key problem that they're thinking they're solving? Maybe we start off with you this time.
Sure. So I think if we look at how we are seeing the advantages over here, one is the entire developer experience. Docker actually has done a good job from an implementation point of view that the developer experience with Docker is really good, and you know it wasn't the case before that you could take an application, same application which runs in QAs can now run in your production environment. I think that's awesome, and that's something our developers want, and they don't quite have it yet, but it's something that's definitely driving that. The second thing I would say is operability. I think as we see that with running at the scale that eBay does, it's really managing and operating these services at our scale is actually very non-trivial. And what we've found is that using containers and using technologies like Kubernetes, which I'll talk more about, but we're actually working very closely with Google on Kubernetes. And we see a lot of promise in how we can actually scale our services horizontally and elastically. And so we are actually very bullish on how it can actually really improve the manageability of our services and our application. So I think those are two of the driving factors for us.
So I think a lot of us have been doing microservices for a long time. We just didn't call it microservices. It's a concept that's as old as time itself. It's the Unix philosophy. You write a really small thing and you try not to change it, and it exposes an API and it does just that. Anyone who wants to contact it uses the API. Like, you could even think of like a router or a BGP server or something that's just burnt into read-only memory as a microservice. It's just a small service. Unfortunately, today I think it's got a lot of buzz. I mean, fortunately and unfortunately, today it's got a lot of buzz. But there's a tendency to think, you know, I can just spray paint microservices over my Java app and it just magically scales. That's not the case. For it to actually scale, you need to do certain things. You need to follow certain patterns, and that's where the notion of microservices comes in today. And if you want to do those patterns at scale and make money, you use containers, and they actually go really well hand in hand because containers are sort of ephemeral. So I think that the reason it's got so much buzz is because there's money to be made and economics takes no precedence.
Yes, certainly agility, developer agility, and the rapid development cycles is what we see across the board as the number one driver, right? So our customers are going from environment deploy times, which used to take maybe hours, like 4 to 6 hours, to minutes sometimes, right? If you have the right set of hosts, the right primitives, and repeatable blueprints for your applications which you can deploy. So agility is one, but it's also the portability and cost savings. So once you start treating your virtualized infrastructure as a general pool, now you can have different dev test workloads or even other workloads that you can bring on and start leveraging that common infrastructure. So it's those three value propositions that we're seeing.
Well, what I would say is that the speed at which you can deliver applications is really going to be the game changer for companies tomorrow. And standardizing on a format gives you that capability where you can say that, I can run at the speed and innovate on my and iterate on my applications as fast as customers who are needing it wants it to be changed. That speed of trying to deliver something is what DevOps is what containers are about, is what microservices is. Ultimately, those terms and those things and those methodologies exist because we are ultimately trying to chase this thing of trying to be very agile with respect to customer use cases and eventually how they get used. So to me, that is the epitome of the use case, and everything else is a side effect of that.
And for me, it's not a matter of the Gartner hype cycle. I think Docker hit the perfect wave of people now realize the benefits of public cloud and the agility of that. Immutable infrastructure and the security that's involved with that. So now if you look at the DevOps pets versus cattle meme, people don't think about their servers. It's now moved up the stack into application. And how do you upgrade your applications and pieces of it with microservices in near real time? So if you have to upgrade, if there's another OpenSSL vulnerability, how do you upgrade your infrastructure, your application very quickly? Docker containers give you that benefit of agility, like other people have said.
So between containers and microservices, if you say chicken egg problem, is containers driving microservices or is it the other way around?
I'd say they're both enabling each other equally. I mean, like Prashant said, like microservices has already existed. Containers have existed for a long time. Now we're just figuring out how do you leverage both of them equally.
So speaking of which, I'm still holding a copy of this book in my hand. I was talking to Dinesh Subravaiti before, I think he's somewhere here in the audience, but his PhD dissertation led to some of the containerization efforts today, and so if he's around, you guys can network with him as well after the event, but that sort of goes back to your point of how long these have been before they caught mainstream fancy, if you will.
Yeah. No, I think that, moving down, you will not see microservices without containers. Now, I'm not saying that, it didn't exist before. Of course, containers also existed in some form. Somewhere in future, I don't see that, you have microservices which is not using containers. So down the lane, microservices will exist with only containers, but containers may not always only do microservices because, microservices is a much, bigger theme that fits in a specific set of use cases and all that. Maybe there are people who are just trying to deploy some teeny mini containers, and you don't need to jump into microservices bandwagon for that, which still means that container remains to be this fundamental unit of deployment, application deployment, and microservice happens to be leveraging that. So that's the looking forward, that's what I think, how they are interrelated.
Yeah, I mean, certainly both can exist independently, right? And there are folks like Netflix and others who are doing microservices on VMs, right? So it's certainly possible, but containers and microservices are a great fit when you bring them together. So it's also possible to do traditional applications in containers, but at the same time, once you start evolving your application, the benefits you get by applying both concepts together are far greater than what you would get separately.
Yeah, I think both these concepts started off with more or less different goals. If you go back to the origin of containers, even before anything in Linux, before the Google engineers did the C group stuff, there was FreeBSD and Solaris, right? Like Solaris and FreeBSD had this concept of jails and zones, and that was essentially about security. If you read the original paper, they started off with this idea that, you know, we have this thing called the chroot, it's the root of your process, but it's not secure because you can just CD out of it and you're out of the abstraction, if you will. And so they built this thing called zones, which is essentially, or jails rather, because jails predate zones. And a jail is essentially something that encapsulates a process. And it's what it's the father of what we today call containers. It's like OS level virtualization. But obviously they had no idea about what microservices are. And microservices also existed sort of independently with, you know, Google doing things like Stubby RPC server, and they had Chubby and various other things, and they just developed this way of like these things talking to each other. So instead of saying, hey, I have a website and here are the 50 engineers that manage it, you now say, hey, I have a website, here are the 30 microservices that back it, here are like the two or three engineers that work on each microservice. And that leads to a lot of benefits. And today we just see that these two things fit well together.
Yeah, so I think, you know, both are very symbiotic, and as I think other folks have said, it's, they both evolved independently. You know, we had C groups, we had Solaris zones, and containers really came out of that. And same thing for microservices. Microservices were there before containers were. In fact, eBay has lots of microservices which are not implemented on containers. Our big, best example is our image service called Zoom internally. It's completely microservices-based architecture, not implemented on containers. I think what's really interesting is that with the advent of, when the adoption of like Docker technologies and cluster managers, what's really come is it's become easier to write microservices. So first it was really, people were reluctant to write Mac. They knew it was the right thing to do, but they were reluctant to write it because who's going to manage these many services, manage the lifecycle, upgrade, agility, you know, infrastructure resilience. It's, these are hard things to do. So what they ended up doing was like a single service and keep adding more and more stuff to it before, and it became a monolith. So like, okay, I didn't really want to do it, but you know, that's reality. I don't want to manage 1,000 services in my environment. Today, I think that's changing. And that's very exciting for me, is that you can actually have the right architecture and you can actually run these services independently, isolated, and you can do it with a lot of agility and much better technologies to manage these services. And that's why I think they're both very complementary.
And I think Docker containers have really enabled, or more fastly enabled, the statelessness of microservices architecture.
Which sort of helps with the agility piece as well.
Yep.
So let's get a bit more personal here. When I say personal, make it more relevant to the work that you're doing instead of generalizing. eBay is one of the largest private clouds on the planet today. So the kind of scale that you see is not something others do at this point. Could you walk us through how are you approaching this transition to newer application architectures, even while there's a lot of legacy out there, and just sort of walk through some of the best practices?
Yeah, so I think if you look at our use cases, as I was mentioning before, it's a lot to do with developer agility and us being able to operate the infrastructure seamlessly. So what we are doing is, I mean, as we are starting off on this journey, I think first part is actually making, operationalizing Docker and Kubernetes at eBay, which is very non-trivial, it turns out.
Step one.
Step one, and actually we are still there. So we've taken a few initial services and we are running them on Kubernetes because we are not running on the Google Cloud right now. So we are deploying, I think we are probably the only, I won't say the only ones, but in the most, at the largest scale, deploying Kubernetes on OpenStack. So that integration is where most of our focus is right now. And with that integration, I think one of the things that we are seeing is there's a lot of challenges with respect to networking, with respect to security that we need to solve to even get Kubernetes to run at scale within the enterprise. So that's one. The second thing is, as we are first going to attack the new services and the new applications which are coming up within eBay, that we are going to move on to Kubernetes, learn from them, and then have a transition path for the legacy applications. Frankly, I've not even started thinking about it. It's still 2017, you know? So that's where we are.
Okay. So switching gears, you know, a lot of the container work is also being handled in the community through open source as well, right? Maybe Prashant, you sort of talk about how are you fostering, nurturing that community to really make this concept successful. And then maybe you can follow up, Vipin, in terms of Conte, talk a little bit about what it is and then really look at who's contributing, who's consuming.
Yeah, sure. So internal to Google, we had a lot of systems we developed with close communication to our customers. So they were sort of tailor-made, and they grew up as the company grew up, and the engineers had low latency communicating between each other, and they just like, you know, said, hey, I want this, and the like Bog is the scheduling system, right? So like somebody went to the Bog team and said, hey, I want this, and the Bog team said, sure. Independently, and you know, without any communication, the outside world was also growing. They got things like Hadoop, they got Zookeeper, which is very similar to Chubby. They got, Hadoop was like MapReduce. They got several systems that work really well, and they were completely outside Google. And so now we're engaging the community in trying to understand how both sides can benefit from this, right? We see our take at things, and we see that here's how we would do it, and you know, in some cases, here's what we did wrong the last time with Bog, and here's what we're doing right now. But in other cases, there's like, we have this component, it's pluggable, you can replace it. And actually, like Vipin is one of the people who wants to replace parts of kubeproxy, which is the proxy daemon that handles networking in Kubernetes, with good reason, because, you know, there are different use cases that need to be considered to like attract a more general audience. And that's what we're trying to get to by reaching out to the community.
So what I would say is, you know, I'll latch on to the place where Prashant left. So how do we do it in a way where we all can benefit from each other? I mean, microservices is a perfect example. Why don't we create these small units that could be completely swapped out as needed, so that together we don't have to replace the whole monolith again? And I go back to Kubernetes as an example. It is made of, you know, small components, or I wouldn't say small, big components, or reasonably sized components which have independent functionality which is separated out. And like you're saying, I'm able to take one of those components out, leverage rest of the Kubernetes just as is. And of course, that's the one that deals with networking. So I'm focusing on trying to bring operational policies for networking. And so we started looking at, you know, why don't we start doing the same thing for quantitative efforts too? Why do one big, you know, repository where we churn all of our code? Why not create a slew of tools that we use in our part repositories first, so that, you know, if someone likes a specific part of our tool, feel free to take that. If you like, you know, bigger things and integrated things, you could take that. So I think Go language particularly, I really like the way, you know, it could expose code to other people to be used almost as is, with completely unit tested and self-sufficient, you know, entities, which is serving just one and very one small purpose. So that is the, you know, way we are looking at it, how community-wise this could, you know, leverage each other's work and benefit.
Okay. So Jim, I think we went through this era of server virtualization. We went through efficiency gains through virtual machines. But it also created a new problem, which was of VMs problem. And then that sort of led to the whole automation orchestration movements, precipitated potentially software-defined technologies. You're trying to solve that in the container space, right? So how real is it? What are you hearing from customers? Could you talk about the orchestration?
Sure. Yeah, so certainly our focus is on that operations and management portion. Right now, orchestration, of course, is a fairly broad term. You could apply it to any layer of the stack. But really the difference that we're seeing, and maybe it's the experience with cloud providers and public cloud, that folks realize and our customers realize that automation is key. And especially once you bring in containers and microservices into the mix, you have so many moving pieces into the layer. Even a, you know, reasonable application of like 10 to 15 services, once you have a team of 8 to 10 developers with multiple environments, you're dealing with hundreds of services to manage and operate, let alone the infrastructure underneath and the security and the network and all of those, right? So certainly we look at Nirmata as a multi-layer orchestration and management tool, but it's everything that we do is driven through policies and from the application point of view, right? So applications driving the infrastructure needs and so on further down the stack. So really it's automate first and automate everything is our mantra, and that's how we do it.
Okay. Mike, from a security standpoint, do you see microservices causing more of an issue with the surface area suddenly expanding. Where does it fit within this whole container microservices conversation?
I look at it from the container aspect. Like with rapid agility of being able to build containers comes great responsibility of how do you secure those containers and know that the libraries or packages you're pulling in are secure. Like, you know, Docker build gives you the ability to build containers really quickly, but how do you know what you're putting into them and validating that? And, you know, there's companies being built like Twistlock to attempt to solve that problem.
Which, incidentally, we'll share today here as well. We have some demos going on with Twistlock. You don't interface with Twistlock
No.
from a Cybric perspective, right? Okay. So I want to just pause here because I think you've gotten a sense of the panelists, what flavor they can represent. Any questions, Bernie in the audience? We'll have maybe two or three questions right now. Let's get a mic to you.
Yeah, Spencer. Just say your name and company name.
My name is Atul. We are a stealth mode company in container space. The question for Sumit was, you know, why Kubernetes over Docker Swarm? If you're going to Dockers, why not go with the complete Docker ecosystem? So that's the question.
Yeah, I think it's a good question. We did some evaluations internally. The Docker Swarm, when we started our evaluation, actually it was probably 18 to 24 months ago. Docker Swarm was still early at that time, but we definitely did a comparison with Mesos much more deeply. So I can answer it more in context of Mesos. And Mesos is very compelling. I think what we really liked about Mesos was the schedulers are very advanced on the Mesos framework, and you can really get a lot of efficiency on the on utilizing your infrastructure. So that was very cool. And in fact, we did deploy Mesos within eBay. Our entire CI infrastructure at eBay today runs on Mesos. And then we started looking at, and as Kubernetes was evolving and the ecosystem around that was evolving, we looked at that. And I think one of the things that really appealed to us about Kubernetes was the fact that we really liked the declarative aspects and the abstractions that Kubernetes had, right? So I think just from an interface and abstractions point of view, we liked Kubernetes more. And there was more like energy around it. And I think also it helped that we formed a good relationship with Google while we were doing the evaluation. So it eventually ended up with Kubernetes. And I would still say that Mesos is probably more mature than Kubernetes when we were evaluating, and maybe still is, I don't know. But Docker Swarm, to be honest, you know, wasn't a fair evaluation when we started, right? And at this, by the time they really started getting traction, we were too far ahead in the journey.
Can I add something to that?
Yeah, so
I just want to add something to his answer. So if you're I mean, as part of the team, I see a lot of this, right? People are always comparing framework X to framework Y, and essentially you're gonna have framework Ys for a couple of years down the line, I think. So if you're comparing two frameworks, I wanna say you shouldn't do it along an axis that addresses a problem that's already been solved. Like, for example, don't do it along, you know, like we know how to scale servers, we know how to cache things, we know how to write, you know, scalable web applications, so to speak. So don't do it along, you know, QPS or pods per second or something, because those problems will just shake out and they'll solve themselves given enough time, because those are solved problems in the industry as a whole. I would personally do it along an axis of things that haven't been solved, at least at large scale, like can you handle virtual IPs? What are the idioms you have to like handle stateful applications? How are you going to handle, you know, managing replicated instances of your app and things like that.
Gopal, the question is, as you scale containers and you operate containers at scale, what kind of operational problems do you see, as in diagnosing, monitoring? Is it because it's a highly dynamic environment? So I'd like your thoughts on that.
Who wants to take a shot at
it? I can take it. Because I am trying to solve that problem. You know, you know, I mean, 10,000, 50,000 containers running in a cluster. You know, first thing you want is to be able to know what's going on. Before even your application, that's the first priority. If you don't know what's going on, then it's a non-starter. To be able to do that scale is very easy if you try to embrace the tools that you are doing it. Themselves are microservices enabled. So trying to get that information and trying to present it out is doable. But what you still need is to be able to say that, you know, what kind of prioritization I want for something that's monitoring versus the application itself. Can I have, you know, a situation where this tiny application, which is not supposed to be killing my monitoring application, is able to take over and just, you know, do whatever is needed. To be able to have that policies to say that how exactly you want to leverage your infrastructure is then becomes the, you know, a side effect of trying to be able to manage this whole thing at a big scale and all that. I have brought a 40-node cluster. I will say that not beyond that. But there itself, I'm starting to see those challenges. So I can imagine how is it going for you, Sunit?
Yeah.
Because it's really out of control at that point, and these are like very ephemeral processes which are coming up and going away.
Right.
So how do you keep track of what happened while this thing came and went down? So so to be able to secure them, to be able to isolate them, is kind of things you will need. You want to make sure that, you know, your production environment is not going to be accessible by something which is your testing environment. And of course, you want to run both of them simultaneously. You don't want to dedicate one you know, network and one storage and one thing for production and other for staging. And even if you do that, you want to always peek in and leverage the spare CPUs, which is going free. And that's the whole promise behind running in containers, is that you can leverage these things to their max and don't run anything if you don't need them. So as long as you have the tools, it's all about, you know, you're going to be as strong as your tools are, and you have the tools to be able to keep this mammoth in control, you're good. And for that, you will need, you know, a very good way of defining, first of all, what you need, and then be able to implement that.
And I think you have to think about the instrumentation of the microservice and right. part of the application versus being container specific.
Mm-hmm.
So you need the monitoring and logging of the microservice,
right.
not of a specific container, because they all should be the same as part of that microservice.
Right. Right. Granular, so, can you go?
Yeah, so I have something to add over here. So I think I mentioned initially that, you know, this year's up till now has only been about operationalizing the cluster manager. We are actually getting ready to run containers at scale. So, and what is it taking for us to get ready to run containers at scale? One is, there's a whole ecosystem you have to create to be able to do this well. One is, we've created the eBay container registry, fully operationalized in every data center, so that your container registry itself scales and it has security and everything. The second thing we're doing is monitoring and logging, as was mentioned, like fully scalable solutions which are accessible, running probably in the sidecars, accessible to the applications and services running in our cluster manager. The third thing is obviously deployment of the cluster itself and being able to add capacity and remove capacity from that. Fourth thing, last but not least, is something that we're paying a lot of attention to is security. So I think you really need to, because you have so many applications which could potentially get to each other, I think having the security access and how you can do micro-segmentation, perhaps policy-based control over which service can access which one, is something you really have to start paying attention to. It may not be something you need initially, but you cannot ignore it. And it's something that we are also looking at as a part of getting ready to run containers at scale.
Let's have one more question.
May I take this one here?
Okay.
I can take, you raise your hand, I'll bring one to you.
So I'm a bit removed. I actually came for beer, so allow me to ask you a question in that regard. I have three points that I wanted to make. One is the performance isolation of containers, meaning when you go and scale at such huge magnitude and you have so many containers running, how do you ensure that they're not going to interfere with each other? Two, and that is in the same context, you could say, how do you live scale up and down the performance of containers. Second, you know, a lot of us have been seeing VMs and how virtual machines migrate from one environment to the other. In the container context, that's not exactly true. Often I hear that it's better to kill a container and start a new one rather than migrate one. And the third point which I wanted to make, beer got to me.
I think let's handle the first two questions you
were
putting up.
I mean, I could take a shot at that. So I think it's what you're referring, you know, it's the noisy neighbor problem where you have different workloads and containers running adjacently, and how do you maintain quality of service on them? I think it's something that I don't know if there is a good solve technically right now, but I think what the way we are doing it is by doing workload isolation, by seeing what kinds of workloads we run on what kind of servers. So we actually create host groups, and then we schedule workloads which are going to be not as sensitive to noisy neighbor problems on the same physical infrastructure. It's probably not a very sophisticated way to handle it, but I don't think we have that much help from the technologies down there right now. That's how we are handling that issue.
Sorry. Go ahead.
Now, I was just going to add, you know, so one thing to keep in mind, and it's, maybe it's kind of the state of where we are today with all of these technologies, most folks are running containers on virtual machines or on cloud instances. So containers are not the only layer of the stack where you can do your segmentation and isolation. And it's really important, and I think there was a good slide deck that Adrian Cockcroft put out a few weeks ago, which talked about segmentation at different layers. Because you're not just segmenting at one layer of your stack, but it's across the entire vertical, right? So that's just something to keep in mind, that you do have the flexibility. And of course, if you use multi-level scheduling and, you know, orchestration tools, you can orchestrate both at the infrastructure layer and at the container layer to get the best of both.
I'll add one comment to it, which is that, you know, to be able to do it at scale, you need intent-based policy that can just ask you what really you want to do, as opposed to defining for every single container, this is the kind of isolation I need, and this is the kind of thing I need. Because you have to do this automation way, you cannot do it any other way. And if it has to be automated, it needs to be the general direction, declarative intent that goes in, and then it percolates all the way down. I know that it could not be done 100% perfectly, but I think we can definitely get a very good amount of isolation with respect to storage access and IOPS and networking with respect to how much bandwidth and resources which are consumed. Of course, CPU and RAM is the most talked about. I was just covering the other parts.
Yeah. I think to address the second part quickly, you need to design an architecture application to be stateless, so then you should just restart the containers because they're not maintaining state, versus try to migrate or fix it.
We'll handle one more question, then we'll break for a demo and come back to the Q&A session again. You had a question.
I had a question to Prasant. Mm-hmm. Google has Borg and Omega. I've read a very scientific report about it.
Okay.
I wanted to have your thoughts about both of them. Secondly, I had a question for you regarding how do you resolve the image creation part of the Docker? Because I run it as a Docker as service too, and my biggest problem is taking one image to various host and starting up within seconds. So how are you resolving that part of it in registry?
Yeah, so let you answer first.
Borg and Omega, well, Borg is a really old system. Omega was the second iteration of that system. Borg, and in some ways Kubernetes is actually a combination of Borg and Omega, and so you could view it as the third iteration, you could view it as 2.5 or whatever. But Kubernetes has a lot of concepts that we thought, the engineers that created Borg thought that they did wrong in Borg, right? So Borg worked at scale, but it did certain things. One example is host port mapping. It did certain things that just didn't work that well at scale. It's not that they can't be done, it's that we think they're a bad idea. That's why Kubernetes has this pod, IP per pod concept. It's a little twisted when you come. I mean, if you're not used to the Docker world, you create a Docker container and it gets an IP and you're like, oh yeah, obviously it should have an IP because you're coming from the VM world and VMs have IPs. If you're used to the Docker world and you create a container on Kubernetes and it gets an IP, you're like, oh my God, this thing is crazy, because in Docker you're used to, at least now Docker has taken over to the IP model, but previously you had like an expose command that you could expose a port to, and then you publish the port, and then you can publish all ports, and then you have to do some crazy like user space daemon that redirects ports and all that fancy stuff, right? So I've definitely taken to the IP model, and I know that we had problems with Borg, and I know that we had problems in other scheduling systems that worked on bare metal that I personally worked on with port mapping. So point being that Borg made some mistakes, and we're trying to do it better in Kubernetes. And Omega was a way to also rectify those mistakes, but you know, obviously not impart that knowledge to the open source community
as a working product?
So to answer your question on how we handle like the image creation and image management, so one thing too that I should quickly explain is just the architecture approach we've taken is we think of the application as your data plane, and Nirmata provides the management and control plane, which is delivered as a service, right? So really, it's up to you where the image registry resides, and that's in your data plane. We're not imposing how that's populated or where that resides itself. Now, we are starting to work with some customers where we start optimizing, pulling, prefetching, and Swarm does a little bit of this too, images on certain hosts. So especially when it comes to production workloads, you want to minimize the time taken. And as you, in Nirmata, we have a policy-driven approach where you could say for environment types which host groups or which clusters you're going to target, so we can warm up those clusters based on that through orchestration.
So guys, hold your questions. We'll get back to more of this. What we also wanted to do was really take some of these concepts that we just discussed between different vendors, different practitioners, applications, and bring that to life. And this is all very early stages in the industry. Not everybody's an eBay, and eBay is still looking to get it into production, but there are a number of people that are trying out various use cases and seeing, what sticks. So to that end, I would want the panel to just take a seat here for a few moments. Let's have the demo. It gives you more context, and then we can start with more questions. So most of you are going through this migration to cloud, whether it's private, public. And in that context, how do these containers, these orchestration mechanisms kick in? So that's kind of the theme behind the demo. So we'll let Doss walk us through it.
I go by Doss. I want to quickly show you the architecture that I put together for this demo. And then I will show the pieces, the components that I've configured with the teams, and then walk you through a very high-level application that is representative of some of the things that I'm showing here. To the team that spoke earlier on, this touches upon some of the things that they mentioned. So in the Google Cloud, I've got a microservices that are running as from Docker images, and are being front-ended by an Appcito Cloud Services proxy for traffic management, WAF rules, and auto-scaling. The bottom parts are conceptual. So as I've talked with Vipin on the content side, we're in early stages of how this will look. But any kind of application policy will start to be defined also within Contiv from a networking policy. And we will use the common denominator of labels that are defined within the Kubernetes master. Now, due to a shortage of time, I ran the Appcito Cloud Services controller out of AWS, which is actually controlling that proxy over there. So here's a little bit of mix and match. Now, the Kubernetes master is spinning up these are Nginx instances on this side, as well as the cloud service proxy. On the Amazon side, I've got the ecosystem with Jim and Ritesh and others that have helped me out, I've introduced Nirmata to container orchestration, and I'll show you that in two environments that have spun up these representative application components, so the catalog card and so on. And the Appcito proxy is also living on the same Docker instance where we're front-ending the application. And I've also introduced Twistlock. Past lives, I was at CipherCloud, and number one thing I saw around the globe was how do you protect data? How do you prevent certain attacks from happening, whether we were encrypting or tokenizing things? So as I looked at Twistlock, where my colleague went, Chenzi, I brought that into the equation so that we can now look at the vulnerabilities down the container stacks. As I mentioned, these below the line are more conceptual as we continue to work with the Cisco teams. And I took the liberty of showing just a private cloud. Yes, there's public, and the gentleman from eBay mentioned OpenStack and Mesos and Docker and what they're doing from their application. And then from an Appcito's perspective, we're embedded our controller into the OpenStack Horizon dashboard. Again, it's just a proof of concept that we've introduced. So that's the architecture. There are other clouds that I've deployed in, CenturyLink, IBM, Bluemix, Azure, and so on. Any questions on the architecture before I start to jump into the actual demo? Okay, so let's start with the left-hand side, which was Google Compute. And down here, I apologize, it's a little tough to read, but you can join me a little later for
over there where I'm showing this in action. I actually have, is this still up? I have to reconnect. So we already have set this up. I set up a couple of servers on Nginx with those different piece parts. And what I'm going to show you here is the actual application, how it's defined within Kubernetes. Now, what we've done is created a couple of YAML files to help orchestrate this. Now, to Jim's point with Nirmata, we could have used Nirmata. Actually, I did. The first catalog that I deployed was using Nirmata. The second one I did was with Kubernetes. So here we are. Let me just clear this up. Hopefully you can see this. So you'll see that I've got a couple of Nginx servers. And then you see that PEP, the third line item. That's actually our cloud service proxy running on that in that instance. And I'll also show you the YAML file. Oops, I'm in the wrong directory here. Pod-wide. Let me change that to node. So you'll see, thank you. So you'll see I've got a couple of instances running with the associated files. So what I've actually done is set this up using the Kubernetes interface, which is now driving the spinning up of these pods and nodes. So with that, what we did next was to drive traffic to that location. And what I've done here is got my simple app here. I'm just gonna reload this thing. And you'll see it change from Nginx 1 to Nginx 2. And then in my dashboard, you'll see that the traffic. So what we have here is in the last 30 minutes, I hit it a couple of times. And you see I've got a couple of requests that I sent through. So this is actually going through that cloud service proxy. And if I drill down, you'll see that I've got some of the IP addresses associated with that. And now we're actually can enforce policy on this, where I can block, allow, redirect, or associate it with different services. So that's the Kubernetes side of the house. On the Amazon side, I've got this set up. I've got a couple of servers as well as the meetup demo instance running there, which has the containers orchestrated from Nirmata. So here's a Nirmata dashboard. And what I've got here is a couple of environments. This is the AWS cloud. And to Jim's point, I got the same setup for whether it's catalog, web client, orders, and ratings in the AWS environment for the Google environment or the Google cloud. So the challenge of how do I replicate my application, one cloud to the other, from dev to staging to pre-prod to prod, those are significant challenges. And here's a quick and easy way to actually deploy that. I mentioned Twistlock. So here's the dashboard for Twistlock. I installed that in both clouds to look at the vulnerability of the containers and the microservices. So if I drill down, this is really it's up to Twistlock's interpretation, and as you see here, and I'm going to drill down a little more, if I look at some of the details, it's really up to them on how they define, what the vulnerabilities are, and how you can actually say that's either in line with your policy or not. So if I select where they actually obtain these policies from, they're actually referencing public databases, in this case NIST, to show that that stack or that container is vulnerable according to this well-known information. So that's how we're building that ecosystem with Nirmata, with Twistlock, using Kubernetes and Google, and obviously other tools in other environments. So now, if I send traffic, here's again my very sexy application here. I've got a catalog, I've got a ratings, and I'm just going to bounce back and forth. And then I come back to my dashboard. Hopefully it hasn't timed me out. Here's my other dashboard. Logs me back in. And then you'll see the same thing, traffic being serviced. Now, to spare you from going down into the command line, show you the Docker images that are running, you're welcome to join me over here. I can show you that. But for the sake of time, you just saw orchestration, microservices. Yes, there were some dummy apps, but here's traffic being passed. And we can now enforce policy in the application layer for these containers and microservices. With that, thank you. And please see me over there after the panel, and I can answer additional questions.
With all these microservices and containers being so ephemeral, how do you provide persistence to your storage? And how do you guarantee quality of service?
You can address that in your panel.
Yeah.
Do you guys want to take a stab at it?
Yeah, so I can tell you what we've done at eBay. So we actually, I mean, I can talk about our implementation. So what we are doing is our, right now we are running our containers inside a VM. We're not running directly on metal. And what we've done is we've done an integration where we can dynamically attach a Cinder block storage device. It's an integration we did with kubectl. So when we spin up the VM, we actually attach the storage so that it's actually visible from the container. So that's an implement. That's something I think we've contributed back as well. We've upstreamed that. So for us, that's the solve for now. It's something that we still haven't tested at scale, but that's how we are angling that problem right now.
Yeah, I'll take a few things there. The 40 node cluster in my lab, I was talking about, those are all bare metal, you know, no VMs. And precisely the problem is, you know, versus how do you provide, you know, distributed storage which is persistent to a container. For a classic microservice application, you may not need that, but my comment is really applicable to applications that you are carrying over from what you have today, to be able to use that persistent storage, because you know some applications will need that. So for quantive volume, a quantive storage solution, we are leveraging Ceph to be able to provide that. And to get the isolation part, we are giving the ability to define what kind of policy you want associated with these container applications. And you could definitely say that, you know, I want these kinds of IOPS rate limiting, and I want these kind of volumes to be given to these applications to do that.
Okay. So somebody wanting to have the legacy environment, they're always in the mood to move to the new models. There is a bridge that they need to cross. What are some of the best practices to make this more seamless when you are having a VM-based environment and you want to start to bring in containerization as well? What's the top use case? What are the best practices? Maybe quick round robin on that.
Surely, you have to take a holistic view of your application and not just try to migrate it to VMs or containers. Like, how do you segment it out into microservices? So what are the core pieces of your application, and how do you have separation of duties? Is, I think, is how you, at a high level, how you look at it.
Yeah, what I would say is that, you know, the best practices differ between developers and ops.
Okay.
Because what you do in development will reflect into the operations directly. So it starts right from architecting an application right, and to be able to define the right interfaces. You don't want to break up something which is not belonging to be separate things to call it then microservices and feel good about it, of course. So what you want is very clean interfaces between these microservice applications. And then, you know, they have to be backward compatible, because you can just swap out something and roll the newer versions and all that. So that's like kind of design the application first to be ready for that DevOps or microservice environment itself. That's a, you know, those are best practices for developers. But then there is best practices for operationalizing those. And those are the ones where, you know, make sure that you have tooling, or you latch onto tooling that can get you the insight about what's going on and how it's going on, who's talking to who. To what kind of resources are being used. Is it like, you know, 40% resources that you are CPU and memory which is going waste, or is it like 80%? You have to know that almost at a live level, and that you can feed back into your analytics engine to do more crunching to figure out how to go back and reclaim that. So for operational, it needs to, for operational, you know, practices, it needs to have a way where you can monitor it, where you can define a way to predictably deploy this application and come back to it if something were to go wrong, and replace this upgrade process, and all that should be built into the tooling.
So Jim, what are you seeing as you straddle both types of environments?
Yeah, so certainly, like with any new technology adoption, right, it's taking small steps and clearly defining goals and objectives along the way. So there's no substitute for that, first off, and understanding what you're trying to achieve. But in terms of some of the technology itself, and what we see, the way we see enterprises taking this journey, is you start with containerization, because now you can package. And starting to think about containers as belonging to the application tier is the first good, you know, step, right? So now you can start packaging your applications in a common format, a common way, and then you can build standardized automation around it. Whether it's Kubernetes, Nirmata, or something else, now you can adopt automation at scale, and then you transform. So if you try to go too fast to the transform portion for whether it's DevOps or microservices, that's a recipe for disaster, right? So really, the way we see it is containerize, automate, and then transform.
Okay.
Coming from VMs, you should actually feel somewhat at home in Kubernetes because we have this concept called a pod, which is a collection of containers that, you know, sort of feels like VMs. So, you know, people coming from VM land are comfortable in them. They get IPs and they share names. So containers are made of two things, actually. They're made of C groups and namespaces. And you have various different namespaces like bin and network and mount and so on. So all the containers in a pod share a network namespace. So like you get an IP, the IP is shared between all the containers in a pod, and it feels like a VM, but the people who are used to using containers can use containers as well. And I think the pod model works because certain things just don't make sense to run individually as containers. If you're running, you know, an Nginx web server and some sort of log collection service for the Nginx, it doesn't make sense if the Nginx crashes and your log collection just keeps running, or the other way around. You really want like these two to know about each other. You want to always deploy them on the same node. You want to deploy them together and evict them together. So I think the pod abstraction is going to be a big help in bringing people from VMs into containers, and you know that, and the other way around.
Yeah. So I think one thing I said before, one is get ready for running the containers, which means make sure that you have the ability to log and monitor and your containers. You have the ability. You have a good container registry, which is scaled out. Get the basics in place. Right. That's one thing I would say. The second thing is, you can actually, as Prashant was saying, you could take your application and even just create a Docker package out of it and start running it as a in a cluster. It's totally doable. I think my recommendation would be, though, that you take a hard look at your application, refactor it, see where, if it's a monolithic application, see if you can break it out into microservices before you start doing that, right? Because that's when you can get the maximum benefit. Because I think one of the things that we see in our environment is that when these services which are built, which are fat services really, they are actually a lot of these services are doing the same thing. So if we had a good set of microservices, we could have leveraged the ecosystem, right? And so that's something that you'll start seeing much more value if you strategically, if you do that. The other thing I would say is invest in service discovery. Because if you have that many microservices without having a good discovery model, you're not going to be able to reuse these efficiently, right? So at a large scale, you're looking at how you scale up your environment. A service discovery and service registry should be a part of the ecosystem.
Yeah, I want to clarify something real quick. I would be kind of sad if someone walked away with the wrong impression. Running stuff inside containers like it's a VM is an anti-pattern, and you shouldn't be doing that. Like a lot of problems come from that. You should be decomposing the daemons that run inside your VM into multiple containers and running them inside a pod. And if you have questions, you can ask me about this anytime.
All right, so let's touch upon an aspect of it, which is sort of peripheral, but still mainstream, which is the role of DevOps, right? What role is a DevOps team or a person playing within an organization? Are they the ones pushing forward for these new architectures, or are they receiving it? Could you just talk a bit about what role the DevOps plays? Mike, maybe give you some airtime now.
Sure. I don't think moving to containers or Kubernetes changes the role of DevOps. I mean, it's development and operations working in concert.
Are they driving this change?
Yeah, I mean, I think both of them are. I think what's driving the change is how do you scale your application more and more and move to architectures that handle like web scale problems. So you know, we move from bare metal monolithic stacks to VMs, and now we're moving to containers and really abstracting that away. So it really comes down to a scale and operational excellence problem.
Okay.
Well, to me, I think DevOps is a cultural, you know, indication. You don't move to DevOps or something like that. You have to start rethinking how you are doing your applications, right from designing it, building it, and all that. If you don't have the test, you know, testing infrastructure for applications built right into it, forget about DevOps. You know, you are going to go back and discover that you have released something which is going to be broken more often than, you know, otherwise, and you're back to square one. So bringing that change comes, you know, in the wholesome way in the overall organization, and it's a more organic, you know, way of evolving rather than, you know, splitting the teams and saying, oh, I'm DevOps, and is it application developer who's pushing this or that. I would say that, you know, as a whole, if there is a goal to achieve the speed at which and the speed at which you want to deliver your applications, then embrace this thing. It will help you. The benefits are clear. It's not like, you know, any hype or anything. And people have proven it at scale, you know, of course. So that is the way I would say that, you know, this should be rather embraced and pushed into the environments.
Okay. Yeah, so I'll answer it first as a developer myself, right? So when I'm developing, you know, what I most want is I want to remove all the barriers to being able to achieve something for that task
right.
I'm trying to perform, right? So really the interesting thing there, but I'll also say as a developer, operations is not necessarily what I want to be doing, right? So what you get once you start combining that is you end up automating most of your operations. And really that's kind of the focus we have taken and said, how do we provide self-service operations to developers, make it really easy to get to that DevOps without having to be, you know, experts in managing infrastructure and all of the other things. The complexities that go with the stack.
Are they actually influencing the decision when you go and pitch Nirmata solutions?
Absolutely, right? And it's interesting where, again, ops is a very broad term, so there's operations of the things like the network, the compute, security, et cetera. And really, developers want to focus on how do they get to that self-service of their application. So they want to operate that application layer, but not necessarily all of the other complex things underneath.
Yep.
So it's coming up with that division, having a policy-based mechanism to define what can be done, and then allowing self-service on top of it. So it is the lines of businesses, it is the developers driving that conversation for sure.
Yeah, I think I agree with that. A lot of the people who've shown interest in Kubernetes, in my experience, have been developers. So I don't have enough context to answer the question, but I can say that there's a possibility that developers will just start doing ops and we won't need DevOps or something.
I mean, DevOps isn't a title.
Yeah, that's actually, yeah. I mean, it's when the dev teams are looking at infrastructure as programmable, and really there is no ops team to throw the application over the wall to, right? I think there's something that I found it is a good story. It's like one of my teams, which was doing server onboarding, so they were writing the automation for automating the servers to come into our data centers. A lot of problems with that, and the ops teams were complaining, we can't operate this. So I said, okay, you know, the team which is doing the development, they should just run the service themselves. It was funny, I mean, we got 3 calls for over the weekend and things like that, and next week it was completely working. So everything was done, right? And I never had a problem again. So I think one thing is from a DevOps perspective, when engineers start taking accountability of also operating their infrastructure, they have this mindset, and they have the mindset that, you know, this is how we have to make this work. I think that first thing is I've seen marked difference in the quality of the services which are being built. The second thing is it's a completely different mindset of that engineer, right? So I think the engineers who are working on Kubernetes, for example, infrastructure, you can't work on it. I think I was just hearing Ashwin from my team and Prashant talk, and they were just talking about networks and IPs and IP density. And they were both like, they both work on Kubernetes, and they actually need to know the way the infrastructure works and how to program it to be a good developer. So I think that distinction today is like it's hard to be just at the application level. You have to sort of understand the infrastructure and the cluster managers and the abstractions and be able to program to it.
And it comes down to senior leadership really driving the culture.
Yeah.
And the 4 tenets of a DevOps culture is collaboration, automation, measurement, and sharing. So how do you implement that versus dev driving something or ops and saying you're doing DevOps?
Right.
Like, does your culture support that?
It's a culture thing. So I'm going to ask one more question, then we'll open it up again, which is, let's say, fast forward it 3 to 5 years from now, right? What are the top problems that you'd like to see resolved for this to really enjoy that mass uptake? What problems are top of mind?
for me, from a Cybric perspective, I think bringing security and those teams into the DevOps culture. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, there was talks at RSA about rugged DevOps and DevSecOps, but there really isn't a platform for
them
today.
Is security still an afterthought today?
Security is either a barrier for deploying or an afterthought coming yelling at you because you deployed a vulnerability. So they need to be part of that software development lifecycle.
At the beginning, yeah.
Yeah, I would say that, you know, security is always a concern when you talk about production deployment. So security has multiple angles. I won't go into them, but, you know, think about, you know, how you access it to how you contain it from the DOS attack's point of view as to resource-wise contention and all that. Then, you know, visibility and diagnostics is, you know, of course, is need to be solved in a big way. I think scale and speed will be solved. I am not worried about that at all. The things that I'm worried about is after, you know, just basic stuff that you start saying, oh, you know, so many containers in a small cluster. Yeah, I was able to do 1,000 on a host. That still doesn't mean I was able to control what's going on there. So those things to me is what I think will be solved in, you know, coming 20 years, but I look forward to that.
So you think you're onto something there, Jim.
Yeah, well, certainly what we're focused on solving is application delivery, operations and management on any cloud, any device, right? So our mission is to make it easy for whether it's a small team or large team, to be able to deploy mission-critical applications. And we've done this as a collective. We've all done this in other domains before, right? We've operated large-scale networks and other clusters, et cetera, bringing some of those best practices into applications itself, right? So kind of seeing that happen in software is very exciting, and that's what we're trying to solve.
I actually think the many known problems that we haven't solved yet, and it would be a failure to continue to not solve them or solve them in bad ways. One of them is security, like has been mentioned. If, you know, 5 years down the line you came, if the solution for security 5 years down the line was, you know, you write some sort of CCOMP profile and then every developer that uses your base image needs to come and tell you, oh, I have this extra syscall I want to make and can you add it to the profile, then I think that would be a failure. There's stateful applications, which you could say, you know, should not actually be stateful. But there are things like Zookeeper and etcd that you still need to be at the heart of your cluster and need to maintain state. And if you don't have a good, you know, working out of the box, just simple solution that maintains state, then again, we failed. There's networking. Networking just needs to be easier. I feel like networking engineers are messages, and that's why networking works today. It's because we just like take on hardships and we're like, yeah, it's nothing, we'll do it. It just needs to be easier for people to access at scale. So, I mean, I could actually, thinking a little more, I could just keep naming problems.
So make the net work.
Make them net work. Yeah, actually, complete consensus on that. Security is top of the mind. We need good solutions for fine-grained access control between applications, which, you know, there are solutions starting to prop up, but I think they really need to prove themselves out. Networking is definitely up there because, you know, the IP density of running containers actually is way larger, especially if you're not running it on a public cloud. So I think if you guys are trying to run containers traditionally, your networking guys are going to just throw up their hands and says, we can't support you, there's no way. So it happened to us. And you know, everybody doesn't have the luxury of having SDN. We have it within eBay in certain environments, and that's been the saving grace for us. So that, and I think the scale, I'm confident as Jim said, I think that problem's going to get solved, but it's definitely, Kubernetes today only supports 1,000 nodes in the cluster. I'm sure Prashant will take care of that at some point, but it's coming. Okay, great. So we need it at 10,000 pretty soon this year. So scale, and then also multi-cluster. So I think being able to go, the ability to have multiple clusters where you can have an application which is distributed across multiple clusters. Some of these could even be in a different cloud. I think that's something. I'm sure all of these problems are going to get solved. But those are some of my top few problems.
So we covered a lot of ground today, you know, so between the audience questions and what we were discussing here. Is there something that you think you want to share with the audience that we missed out on that's kind of top of mind to you before we throw it out to the team here?
I think if you're an entrepreneur, Prashant just gave you a bunch of great ideas to get started on this.
No, startup pickers, I have one more. I mean, if you guys know about, this is something I've been wanting to, I just don't have the time. Do you guys know what preemptible VMs are on GC? They're like VMs that could get preempted. They cost like 70% of your actual cost. So you should run a Kubernetes cluster with a master on a non-preemptible VM. Run all your nodes as preemptible VMs, so they cost like 70%. And run a replication controller and a service and end replicas, and just say, give me a binary, I'll do this for you. And you're actually running on preemptible VMs, you're charging them the cost of a VM, but you're managing the statelessness and failover from Kubernetes.
So you work for Google, but you're reducing revenue for GC.
That's my idea, I just haven't had time to do it.
So we have customers doing exactly that on AWS, where they have spot instances and on-demand and other instances, and they're using Nirmata to keep the application up and running.
The trick is fault tolerance in that.
Absolutely, and it's detecting, so with spot instances, you get a termination warning, so you have a couple of minutes to migrate containers. Or at least bring up new instances, et cetera. There is also some startups, like there's a startup called Spot Instance, which is trying to do that across clouds.
My idea. Yeah.
But certainly.
It's all on video now, so you're going to have some hackers coding away.
Yeah, so but dynamic applications and dynamic infrastructure is how we see it too.
All right, so one word answers. What is the fastest innovation going to happen? Public, private, or hybrid? Pick one.
Ooh. I would say fastest would be probably at this time, I would say is hybrid, would be my pick.
Hybrid?
Yeah. Fastest public, most interesting hybrid?
Public.
How about laptop? Because that's where containers are built.
Is a laptop in a public cloud or a private or hybrid?
Public, hands down.
Okay. All right, guys. The forum's up to you. Let's have a few more questions. First hand up there.
I think, the complexity is increasing a lot. And I think Vipin, you started alluding to the fact. So, none of you guys, talked about sort of SLA. So if you have an application and you have an SLA and, something's going wrong and you have, hundreds of microservices. So how are you sort of monitoring, the SLAs that each service is providing in the context of the overall application, and how do you troubleshoot if something is not actually, meeting that SLA?
Yeah, so I can take a crack at that. I think so right now, I'll talk about it in context of our traditional applications which run at eBay. We have actually a very massive monitoring and logging system. We instrument everything, right? We know exactly what's going on with the application. If there's any slowdown in latency and response time, we have dashboards and alerts, and we have big data systems which are collecting all the metrics, and it goes off. So if it falls below a threshold, I think we will alert our site operations center. We'll get the developers on call, and it'll be there. So I think the main thing is that you have to have had made the investment in instrumentation, logging, monitoring, and then not only as frameworks, but customize them to your application so that you can actually consume them and act on them. And we've made a lot of investment in that.
Yeah, one thing I would add to that is just, fast recovery and remediation times, right? Because with containers, of course, things are much faster than VMs. So if your monitoring and your orchestration systems can keep up, it's that detection and recovery. I heard somebody say at a conference once, it was interesting, they said something like, it's amazing how many 10 milliseconds outages you can have and nobody will know, right? So, which is sort of true, you can do things very quickly underneath.
This is actually where containers shine, actually. You can set requests and limits, and you can say, I have N instances of my app, this is how much RAM I expect them to take, but if they take as much as this much, let them do so, and you can make sure it doesn't go over that limit. So that makes it much easier to enforce an SLA, in fact, than traditional applications. So the problem with running a VM is you give it, like you're running a hypervisor and you're running a VM on top of it, and the hypervisor gives the VM like 1 gig of RAM and it doesn't know if it's actually using the 1 gig. Maybe the OS is using like 10 megs or something, we hope. But with containers, you can say, give it 1 gig and, it now needs 5 gigs and it's a really important application, let's give it 5 gigs. You could dynamically scale it up and down.
I have a more of a
networking centric question.
There was a little bit of, you know, you all discussed how dynamic the networks are. With the programmable networking on the horizon and different networking architectures coming into play, particularly large data centers, scale up, scale out, vSwitch, what do you think is going to happen? Is networking impacting containers, or containers are going to change networking? It's an abstract question, but I'd like to hear from you.
Yeah.
With this massive scale,
let me take that.
You
know, being a networking guy here, you know, I'll start off with Sunit's comment that, you know, is it a luxury for the people who have SDN? Not really. So it doesn't have to be like that. You could have your standard network and still get containers, the flexibility and agility of creating networks on demand. Going back to your question as to, you know, what is influencing what? It's always applications. You know, start from there and you trickle down. Network is a means to run applications. Storage is a means to run applications. Compute and servers and RAMs and CPU, these all things exist because you have applications. So it has to be driven down from there, which means containers are going to drive what needs networking needs to be able to support for the new class of applications, for microservices and all those things. And if it doesn't move as fast, of course, people are going to solve problems in different ways. But you know, we can always solve it in a way where it could be incremental rather than, you know, ripping apart everything and saying that, oh, you know, you have to set up a brand new network in order to try out networking that is needed for containers. You could have any type of on-prem network, which could be, you know, all modern-looking cloud fabrics to standard, you know, topologies that are prescribed out there, and still achieve containerization and get the native networking and performance. I think performance is the biggest part, because the moment you start doing encapsulation and all those things, you lose a little bit of that. So.
Question over here.
So I have a question which is more looking from the top down. So now we have an application that could have 100 microservices, and if you look at the pictures that Twitter and Netflix published and Gil Group, they show in their service dependency hell with all of these hundreds of services. What do you think is the best way to actually manage the new application structure based on this complex picture? Is Docker Compose the right way? Is Cloud Foundry Manifest, you know, in that space? How do you think we should express those dependencies? What's the best way to do it?
I can take a crack at that. I won't answer it from a tooling perspective, because I haven't quite looked into how Cloud Foundry is addressing that problem. I think one thing is that as you get into this environment where you're running a lot of services, and the density is very high, and also security is into the picture, that application dependency information is really, really important to have, right? So the way we are approaching that is in two ways. One is discovery-based. So one is because we instrument all of our applications, we have a CMDB system, we are actually able to get all the application, what application is actually talking to what service. So that is information that is discovered. Now, the second part is actually declarative. So going forward, when you create an application, I think you need to have a mechanism where you can actually declare the dependent services on which this application depends upon. And that's important for lots of reasons. I think security being definitely one of the big use cases, but it's not the only use case. So I think you'll have to make the investment in having some kind of technology or tooling which can actually both discover as well as have some tooling in your application lifecycle, that when you create this application, you can actually declare the dependencies or the other services. And one of the things which is very interesting is in our environment, we take the same application and we run it in QA environment. And because the application dependencies are the same, whether you run it in QA or in prod, but the instances to which are different. And that has to be dynamically determined depending upon the environment. So that's something that we have to dynamic. So those are use cases that we have to handle. And then we also have to make sure that applications which are not allowed to talk to each other or services should be actually blocked. So again, this is one of those things when I said what are some of the important challenges that we need to solve. Security is one of those challenges. I think once you have the ability to enforce that security and you have application dependencies coupled together, then I think you'll be able to but it's we are not there yet from a technology point of view.
I think you can distill it down to three common things. You need service discovery.
Yep.
You need service authorization. So can this service talk to this service? Are they authorized to do though? And then you have to have application infrastructure defined the policy as code. And then you can choose whatever tool or technology that you have religious conviction about to do that.
Question over here. Going back to a question I think that was asked before about what you might be worried about the future with containers. Docker is fairly young, went gangbusters, right? And now they're trying to suck up the entire environment, right? It's actually very hard. You hear a lot of grumblings from partners just working with Docker right now.
I was waiting for somebody to ask that.
Wasn't on your list, you should ask. But partners are having a lot of trouble working with them right now, and LibNetwork with Kubernetes right now is kind of a big arguing point between the two companies. Are you worried about, is OCI enough? Is, you know, the Open Container Initiative, is that going to push the engine itself forward enough? Are you going to be able to, you know, ride the tide, if you will, with that? Or are we going to see another fork besides Rocket or something else down the line, and we're going to start seeing maybe some fragmentation in the engine market, and you're going to have to worry about what engine you're running everywhere?
Ransi's good implementation of OCI, I believe. I don't have too much experience with Ransi yet, but I can say that I've looked a little bit at Containerd, and it looks like, so for those of you who don't know, OCI is the sort of spec that everyone's agreed upon. Ransi is an implementation of that spec. Containerd is sort of a wrapper around Ransi that does some cool stuff. And this gives you a container runtime. And there are other container runtimes that are going to come up. Rocket is one such container runtime. I've heard tale of other people developing container runtimes, but I can't authoritatively comment on them. But I can say that, you know, Containerd as such looks like Docker engineers did some of the best practices things and sensible things that other people would find a little difficult. They use gRPC, they use HTTP2. You don't have to do it, but it's probably a good idea to do it if you did. They use EPOL, also another thing that you don't have to do, but a good idea to do if they didn't, right? So you could, if you didn't care, just go out and grab this. If you do care, then, you know, maybe you want to do like systemd, some sort of systemd container runtime that like orchestrates Ransi or something else. But what I'm saying is, like, there could be multiple container runtimes, but I don't think it's going to warrant a fork of any kind. And the thing about LibNetwork was not so much that, you know, it was anything political or anything. It was just that CNI and LibNetwork right now aren't too compatible, and we didn't feel that it was worth the time and investment required to make them converge. This doesn't mean they will never converge or anything. It just means that currently today, given our priorities and given the teams and how they think, we're just going to do this.
So I want to add one comment to it, which is that, you know, as long as format is same, player could be anything. So the format is not going to be multiple moving forward. You know, Ransi is a runtime for OCI container format. So as long as format is the same, you should know how to interpret that format and be able to play it. Now, you could have a small, tiny, you know, device to do that, or you could have a big, you know, fancy way of running the format. Networking itself, I've implemented both versions. We can talk about it. You know, it works. It's just that I have to do different things, but it works.
Yeah, so beyond the runtime, though, and I think you were maybe alluding to some of this too, there's a whole lot of stuff that happens above to make applications a reality. So I think there is work to be done there, and we're hoping CNCF picks up the slack in that space. And even going back to the earlier question on application modeling, describing behaviors, things like that, seeing some compatibility and some joint work would be great.
We'll have one more question, and we'll let you guys meet up with the panel and network.
I'll give that gentleman a chance. I think you raised your hand up first.
This question is for Prashant. You mentioned stateful applications a couple of times. Can you talk about some of the issues there?
Yeah. So if you're interested in running stateful applications on Kubernetes, I can give you the GitHub issue on the top of my head. It's 18016. You should go and read it up. And at the end of the issue, you'll essentially see me saying, if you have an example of a stateful application, please describe it in elaborate detail so we don't get it wrong.
right? So if you're running ES, or you're running Elasticsearch, or you're running Zookeeper, or you're running etcd, I want to know the challenges you're facing in like scaling your etcd cluster from 3 to 5 members, or updating the images, or whatever, right? I don't know. I just don't want to get it wrong. But this is essentially a really important problem we need to solve for 1.3, and there are a couple of ideas and ways to solve them, and I think we'll get it. We're kind of close. Storage is a big problem. So the problem here is that, like someone from the cloud brought up, these containers and microservices are supposed to be ephemeral. So you have to tolerate them going down and coming up. But there are certain applications that don't tolerate them. But if you stare hard at it, the problem really is that you have some stable network identity, like I was telling Ashwin just before the talk. You have some stable network identity, you have some stable storage, and you always want the same network identity to come up with the same storage, and you don't care what's in between. The IP can change, the OS can change, whatever, it can all change. This DNS name needs to hook up with the storage, and most of your applications will work. Now, there are certain weird things that, like, certain applications throw weird twists into this. Like, if you've set up a MySQL Galera cluster, you know that, like, it doesn't cooperate. It needs to come up with a quorum of one, and then you need to update the other configs to like point to this guy, and then you need to update this guy's config. So there's that twist. And then, Elasticsearch has its own twist. And like, that's why we call these pets. They each need like sort of special pampering. But for the most part, the pattern is there are a class of applications that need stable identities. And it's not recommended that you, run millions of these, but they do exist and we have to solve them. And if you don't really need this, don't use it.
Yeah, so just one thing I would add to that is beyond stable identities, where we have seen the biggest challenge is if the identity is coupled to something in the infrastructure, right? So, just to kind of think of it from more abstract terms, every application has state, right? It doesn't make sense to have applications without state. It's how you externalize and manage that state that matters. So it is possible to bring up clusters and share information, and we do that sort of as a staging algorithm as we're scheduling and bringing up even more complex clustered applications. But it really comes down to where we have run into challenges is if you have an application that depends on something like a specific portion of an infrastructure, or always has to be on a particular coupled to, whether it's network or a MAC address or something like that, then that becomes challenging in this containerized and microservices world.
Shashi, there's one last burning question here.
Hi, this is Tuprasan. I'm Raj. My question is, we know in AWS, auto-scaling is very simple. If one container or one EC2 is going to 80%, then you can spin up another EC2. So is that solved in Kubernetes? Because what I see is you need to just give the RC, application controller, scale to 1 or 2, whatever the number you want. But is that automated with the in conjunction with CPU percentage utilization?
So auto-scaling groups is coming soon. That's from GCE. But there's also horizontal pod autoscaler, which you should look at. There's some examples that we'll walk you through. It uses Heapster, which if you're not familiar with, is the thing that collects stats from nodes, or exports it rather. And HPA, which is the pod autoscaler, gets its stats from Heapster, and it will scale your application controller as you tell it to.
Okay, so I really like the way that Prashant's face lit up when the stateful question was asked. You could see the passions shine through.
18
months. So, on that note, I actually want to sort of conclude the panel and allow the panelists to intersperse and mix with you guys for the next 15 minutes or so, their time permitting. And I really want to thank the panelists first, Sunit, Prashant, Jim, Vipin, and Mike, for the time that you have taken to come out and be here today and share your knowledge and expertise, and likewise to all of you guys as well.